Good morning, Exchange. You guys can stand up and worship with us this morning. Hey, 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 hey. Man, and His love is so great, and that's what this first song is all about. And we guys want you to feel comfortable here. It's a place where we can express our love for Jesus so freely, and we're so grateful for that this morning. Here we go.
Nothing else. but to your name we lift up all praise. Jesus, your love so great. Oh, bring me closer, I welcome what's in store. Sharpen my faith, Lord, I wanna see you closer. No matter what comes, no matter what comes, when I invite you near, I see a victory. A victory. The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Yeah, my God will never fail. Yeah, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle.
Turn it for good, and you turn it.
it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good, and you turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good, and you turn it for good. 'Cause I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. Yeah, I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. Yeah, I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. You take it all. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good, and you turn it for good. You turn it around. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good, and you turn it for good. We're gonna worship our way through this battle, for the battle belongs to you, Lord.
I was thinking about this earlier today, and yesterday I was told, hey, you're leading worship tomorrow. I'm like, uh-oh, here we go. And man, this morning I forget to do this. This morning I was like, okay, Holy Spirit, this whole thing's on you this morning. And I mean, it seems obvious, right? But I was doing that, and man, there's all kinds of darkness and tough times always happening, right? For everybody in our lives. Like, we have great times, we have chaos. But the more I see these hard times and these difficult times, because my faith is growing, I'm starting to say, good. Oh, tough time. This is going to suck. I'm like, good. Because the more I go through these hard times and I'm leaning on God and He gets me through it, the clearer I see Him working in His plan. It just gets cleaner and cleaner. And that's a shelter of faith that I'm starting to build. And sorry, that went into, I guess, a bit of a testimony there. But there was a time when I would say, "Oh man, if this ever happened, I don't think I would be able to go through that. I wouldn't make it if this ever happened." And I would think worst case scenarios. And so, you know, back when this journey began for me, leaning on a power much greater than myself, which is Jesus Christ, and having a Christian community, that faith and that shelter just gets stronger and stronger. And I go, you know what? It's all good. It's out of my hands. It's all good. And we lean on you, Jesus.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Peace.
Amen.
Oh, amen. Oh, amen. Oh, amen. Oh, amen. Oh, amen. Oh, amen.
The
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace.
Be healed.
Amen.
He's for you. He's for you. He's for you.
thousand generations, and your family, your children, their children, their children. May His presence come before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you. He is with you, He is with you, He is with you. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going, in your weeping and rejoicing, He is for you, He is for you, He is for you,
He is for you,
He is for you,
He is for you,
He is for you.
Amen. Wow. So good. My name's Chris Brookbanks. I've got some announcements for you guys this morning. You guys can take a seat real quick. So if you haven't done so already, make sure you check us out on social media, Facebook and Instagram. We had a quick name change, exchange.church, if you're looking for us. That's where we're posting any updates and everything we have going on throughout the week. So make sure you guys check us out if you haven't done so already. So I'm sure we've all heard about the new guidelines. I know a few of us got stopped at the door for having some coffee, trying to bring it in this morning. So for right now, guys, no coffee and or food or drinks at all whatsoever in the theater. And let's do our best to keep our mask on at all times when we're, mingling, speaking to each other, and even in the seats as well. But I heard something about Pastor Drew bringing us all around a coffee in a couple weeks, so we have that to look forward to. So make sure you guys are praying into that for the new year. There's prayer and praise cards in your cup holders besides your seats. So if you guys have any prayer requests or any praise requests, make sure you guys fill those out. Drop it in the offering bucket on the way out. We actually have a couple praise announcements, I guess, coming at you this morning. So first of all, as you know, we've been praying into the legacy offering for the last few weeks, probably about a month now. So I just wanted to let you guys know that thanks to the generous hearts of Exchange Church, God has provided us with over $25,000 for that legacy offering, which is amazing. So we're so thankful that to be a part of such a generous church. Another praise report that's so cool. So we just wrapped up the Goodness Project, where we saw over 500 families come through and get clothing and jackets for the winter time. So that's so cool that we're able to, that's something that we were praying into, just helping out and where we can be a part of the West End of Windsor. So, man, so cool that we saw over 500 families come through and get some help this Christmas season. So, guys, December 23rd is coming up, so Christmas Eve service. This is actually our last service of 2021, other than the Christmas Eve service at the theater. So, Water's Edge. Make sure you guys jump on the Facebook page, share, invite your friends. We've actually moved to two services instead of 6:30. We're going to be doing 6 p.m. and 8 p.m., which is so cool because we filled up too fast, so we have to extend to another service. So the 6 p.m. is completely full. If you guys wanted to bring some friends or you haven't already signed up, you can jump into that 8 p.m. service and make sure you guys register on Facebook so that we can keep a tally of everybody who's coming out. And with that being said, no service on Boxing Day, which is the 26th, which will be the next Sunday. Also, the kids ministry program right now is doing birthday cakes for Jesus. So if you haven't picked up your birthday cake for Jesus yet, we've got some red polka dot bags just right outside the theater. So you guys can pick them up outside on the way out, take them home and make some birthday cakes for Jesus this Christmas season. So guys, we got offering this morning as well. So if you want to partner with us, we do have a couple different options. So first of all, you can give us an e-transfer at exchange@ecwindsor.com, or you can drop any offerings in the buckets on the way out. If you're new to Exchange, no pressure. But if you call Exchange home, once again, we're so grateful for your financial partnership there. So let me pray, and then we'll get back into worship. Unless, Brian, you want to pray? Lord, thanks so much that we can gather here this morning, throughout these times with everything going on, that we can still get together and worship together and hear your word, Lord. I pray over Pastor Brad this morning that you would just speak through him and that you would open us up, Lord, allow us to hear your word, what you want us to hear, Lord, and just be with us throughout the week and use us through this Christmas season to share your word with others, Lord. I pray for the Christmas Eve service, that it would be absolutely amazing, that we would touch some people's hearts, Lord, and maybe some new people that we've been praying for. And just thanks that we have the opportunity to get together in your name, Lord. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
You guys can stand if you like for one more song and a half here. And how good was Larissa today, though? She's a rock star. She had to go.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you, holy. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Lead me in your love. Lead me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Yes. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. You're holy. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are. Love, leave me in your love. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you.
Man, God puts people in your life and who that's supposed to be when he needs to, right? And when you look for that, they're there. And I just love that, the feeling of that song, because it's, he's so worthy, and he builds around us, right? And into each other. And there's just this togetherness about that song that is, man, wherever two or more are gathered, right? It's just a feeling, and it's just a presence that's there. We're so, so grateful for. We're going to bring a Christmas vibe in right now. So help us sing along with this. We only do these once a year, right? So we might need a little bit of help. But all right, let's do it. We're going to do what we know of this song. Here we go. But not to minimize it, I think this song is so powerful, and I want this song to just wash over this place right now, and you guys to accept his presence and recognize that he's here and he's got his hands all over Exchange Church today. Come on.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining, it is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he your care, and the soul felt his word. Yeah, a thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder
here. God, we're so grateful that we get to gather here amidst everything that's going on in this already hectic Christmas season. And we're so grateful that we have a place to worship. And we're grateful for you, God. We're grateful for the people that are here today at Exchange Church. And just keep on blessing us during this Christmas season. We're grateful. Thank you.
Exchange, are you there? Are you there? Am I there? Me? Can you? Yeah? You got? Yeah? Are we there? Okay. All right. Okay. This is so good. Thanks, Chris. That's okay. You remember that clip? I just had to show you that clip from one of my favorite all-time Christmas movies because my mom always used to say that the most important meal of the day was
breakfast.
Yeah, so maybe you had the same mom that I did, so that's good, Sue. So I wanted you to see this because, I mean, that's how good, that clip shows us how good Christmas Eve service is going to be. It's going to be that good. It's going to be like spaghetti and syrup and crushed like Pop-Tarts and M&M's all rolled into one. And it's going to be so good. How many of you looking forward to Christmas Eve? Yeah? Some of you are. Yeah. Okay. So listen. Yeah. And again, with these guidelines, here's what we're going to do. We're going to be as fun as we possibly can be, because that's what we know of life in Jesus, right? He came to give life, and part of that is fun and being alive, right? But we're going to be safe, right, gang? We're going to be safe. We're going to make sure everybody's good. And for those of you who can get in on the 8 o'clock service, can I encourage you to do that? Some of you have canceled, and I get that. And it's all good. It's all good. But this is an opportunity for you to, again, invite your family, if that works out in terms of your family tradition. We just want you to be a part of this because we don't want you to miss it, because it's going to be that good. And, man, it's been so neat to be able to see us pack out one service and, again, fill another service. So how many of you are planning on coming? Hey, can I just, okay. So that's good. Now, here's the other thing I just need to say. We're not going to be able to live stream it. Okay, so basically, as Chris said, the beginning of our Christmas season is our Christmas Eve. We're not going to be streaming it that night. We don't have the capability to do that. So if you want to catch our Christmas Eve service and you're not going to be there, you will catch it on Boxing Day. That's what we're going to be doing, okay? So deal, is that good? You guys okay with that? Nobody's like mad at Pastor Drew for that? Okay, good. So one person, that's all right. He can buy you two coffees, okay? Which would be so good. And hey, Exchange, anybody else ready for Christmas? Anybody wishing for a good Christmas this year? Yeah, because here's what we know. We know that our God is a good God, amen? That he promises you and I to taste and see that he is good. He actually has made a promise to us, that we who are in the land of living will see the goodness of our God. How many of you are living? How many? Yeah, some of you need to check your pulse. Go ahead, do it with me. Just check your pulse. Everybody living here? Okay, so he's made you a promise that we're going to see the goodness of our God in the land of living. Why? Because every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, in whom there's no changing or shifting. He doesn't change like all these guidelines, okay? He doesn't. He is constant. He is with us no matter what. And not only this, but as Brian was singing, man, Brian and the team did a great job being thrown in. Hey, didn't they do a great job? Can we just show them some love? I just love having a front row seat, watching people take steps of faith with knees knocking. And they still take a step. They get out of the boat. And man, I just love to hear how Jesus is growing his goodness in and through us. But I'm so glad he sang that song. We're going to see a victory. Anybody need a victory? Anybody need a victory this Christmas? Because I do. But I love this. I love the chorus. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it to, say it with me.
Good.
Yeah, you turn it to good. That's how good our God is. And it's one of the themes that I've been hearing throughout this Christmas series from cradle to crown. I've been hearing this, just the goodness of God to us, Exchange Church. And it's a theme that's just overflowing. I mean, Pastor Drew has been doing such a great job preaching and leading. It's like the Maple Leafs have already won the cup. Right? Isn't he doing such a good job? And man, one of the themes that has been overflowing in my heart throughout this season, as I've been sitting in these messages and pondering them and reflecting, I've just been overwhelmed with the goodness of God, that I have seen the goodness of God, and I want to see the goodness of God in the land of the living. Amen? Maybe you guys are here in person, those of you that are online, thanks for joining us online. Because we wanted this message to prep us, our hearts, for what it was that Jesus actually had for us. And as I have been thinking about this, you know, I'm convinced that the darker the night, the brighter our light, and the badder the bad, the gooder the good. That's not good English, but I'm just going to say it anyway. And anybody else convinced? Is there anybody else here online or in person convinced that we need to see a little more goodness of God in our world this Christmas? Anybody? Or am I the only one? Yeah, okay. Man. So how does it come? How do you and I bring goodness into the world? And if you said, yep, from cradle to crown, you're absolutely right. It's what Jesus did. He emptied himself of all but love, and he descended into goodness. He descended into greatness. And we want to be able to do the same thing. If you and I make space for God so that we can bring God and his goodness into our worlds this Christmas, I think things will change. In exchange, just imagine this for a second. What if you and I were so filled with Jesus this Christmas, so pregnant with the possibility and promise and the power of the Holy Spirit that God used us to bring his goodness, bear his son again into this world? What would that look like? Because if you do, I want you to grab your Bibles, turn them on. I want you to open your notes apps. And let's go. Anybody say, let's go?
Let's go.
Okay, some of you with me. So this is Pastor Brad's version. Again, forgive me, okay? But I love being able to sit in the text of the Word of God that's inspired, okay? Now, this version is not inspired. I hope it will spark some creativity in you. But the way I do it is in order to make this stick to me, I call it the PBV. It's the PB version. How many of you remember that, right? Pastor Brad's version, or if you like, the peanut butter version. Why? Because I want it to stick to you. Okay, are you good with this? Okay, so this is Pastor Brad's version of the story recorded, the Christmas story recorded in Luke. Y'all ready? Anybody ready? Okay. About 6 months into Lizzie's miracle conception, Gabe, God's top angel, picked up his new assignment. It read, destination, Nazareth, kind of the size of Cottom. Contact, Mary, a virgin pledged to be married to an ordinary Joe. But both of them have the last name Davidson, or descendant of David. See how I did that? See how I did that? Thanks, you guys, you're with me. Message, it's a really good morning, Mary, because you are highly favored. Anybody named Mary here this morning? Yeah, I see one. So good. It's a really good morning, Mary, because you are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Mary got a sense that this was all set up and there was more to the message. So Gabe cut to the chase. Holy Spirit will come upon you in such a way that you'll get pregnant and bear God's one and only son to the world. His name, pretty common, Jesus. But he's the new Moses, Aaron, Elijah, and David, all in one, promised Messiah man. Mary's young, but she is naive. She's heard about the birds and the bees, and this doesn't jive. But she hears him out because it's not like every day you get a visit from an angel. And she realizes that she doesn't have to make space for God, but she gets to, and she's ecstatic. Joe, on the other hand, not so much. But that'll be Gabe's next assignment. One last bit of the message. God's plan for bringing the good news includes both teenagers like you, Mary, and twilighters like your vintage cousin, Lizzie. Because if you're not dead, you're not done, and you're never, ever too young for God to use. Do not be afraid, Mary, for no one and nothing is an impossibility for God. I believe, I receive, and I say yes. Lord, yes. And with one little yes, she began to grow it and show it so she could bring it, bring God into our world. And with that, Gabe rang up an Uber and handed him Joe's address. And all God's people said, hey, listen, I want to pray. So Jesus, we're so grateful that you are here and you've come near. And you want us to bear you to the world. But to be really honest, we don't have a clue how to do that without your help. And I can't speak your words without your help. And so we're praying that the Holy Spirit would be the one who helps us listen, the one who helps us do, as we would seek to bring your goodness into such a broken and hurting world. And we pray these things, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. So I've entitled this message called Bring It. Can you all say bring it? Yes. Bringing it. So how do you and I bring some goodness, some more goodness? How do we bear Jesus into our world again this Christmas? And what a great question for those of you who are asking that. And I want to take a lesson, four lessons, four things, four and no more, from Mary's life. And if you're taking notes, here's the first one I want you to hear that we need to do in order to bring some goodness, to bear some goodness again to our world this Christmas. You and I say yes to his goodness. We just say yes to his goodness. Can somebody just say yes to his goodness? Come on. Yes. Yes to his goodness. I need his goodness. And I just love this. What if you and I, this Christmas week, every single one who are watching on our live feed or here in person, what if we just decided that this week, this crazy week of Christmas, you know crazy week? We just carved out some space for Jesus. And before we walked into our worlds and into the craziness and everybody else's agenda and even our agenda, we just got alone with him, with the Christmas story, with our prayer journal. And we just opened it up and allowed Jesus the space that he needed to meet us in this place. What if every single one of us did that? Before we went ahead with our agendas, before we got into anything else, we took a walk. And we just said, Jesus, I say yes to your goodness. I need more of your goodness in my life. Rather than allowing everyone and everything else to rule us this week of Christmas, what if we practice some self-leadership and let Jesus set the agenda for us? Let him be the Lord and liberator of our Christmases 2021. You see, some of us need to come apart because we're coming apart. And I decided a long time ago that I needed to come apart regularly because I was going to come apart if I didn't. And you know, when I do, you know what I hear when I come apart? When I just make some space for Jesus. I hear, I'm already loved. I'm already chosen. I already am who you've spoken. I receive his first word to me. Did you catch the first word that God speaks to Mary? You're highly favored. Highly favored. And I'm with you. You know, I find that when I run, when I get busy, when I get scared, when I hear all the noise, you know what I'm looking for? I'm looking for security. I'm looking for assurance. I'm looking for affirmation. I'm looking for attention. I'm looking for just the truth that I'm loved. And oftentimes I end up running in all the wrong places, especially the week of Christmas. Is anybody with me or is it just me? And I just go, oh my goodness, I need to hear this. God's first words to Mary, you're beautiful. Loved perfectly, completely, inside and out. When I was in grade 9 a while ago, it was a little while ago, I went to John McGregor Public School, high school, actually in Chatham, Ontario. Anybody know where Chatham is? It's kind of like Cottam, you know? Angel Gabriel never goes there. And I remember I was an insecure high schooler, grade niner. Any grade niners here in church? Yeah. You remember, anybody remember grade nine? Okay. Oh, man, I walked into the gym because Friday night, it was our basketball team after football season got done. It was basketball, and Friday nights were always, again, juniors played first and then the seniors. And I remember walking into the gym. Our seniors were playing, and they were playing a team from Detroit, a visiting team for Detroit. That was cool, being able to have a team from Detroit come over and play from, you know, Chatham. And I remember going in. I was a little late, just getting in on the seniors game. And as I walked in to the guys' gym, we had girls' gyms and guys' gyms back in the day. And as I walked into the guys' gym, the opposing team's cheerleaders were doing a cheer. And they were in the center court. They're kind of rallying their team. And the cheer they were doing, I still remember, it went like this. U-G-L-Y, you ain't got no alibi. You're ugly. Huh? You're ugly. Huh? And when they said you're ugly, they pointed right at me. Yeah, thanks, you guys. Like some of you are going, like all the moms are going, aw. Right? All the guys are going, oh, my goodness. You know, I still remember that. Why? Because it imprinted me. Because there's a world that is telling us we're not beautiful, we're not highly favored, we're ugly, or we don't measure up, or whatever label that you want to put. You see, God's first words to Mary is that you're graced. This is so, so good. Oh, I mean, what would it look like, gang, if you and I went into the world every day with our self-esteem not up for grabs? Not based on performance or appearance or people's opinion or self-perception. What if you and I got real comfortable in our skin, and what if we taught a whole generation that their identity was in the goodness of God, that God made them good and he sees them good and they are made and saved by his goodness and grace alone? What would that look like? And what would it look like if some teenagers taught us that we have a choice every single day? That we can choose to feel good about ourselves or bad. Because of what God has spoken to us, we have a choice now to take control over our own self-esteem, of how we go into this world and what we're looking for and where we're looking for love. What would that look like? If we made choices to feel good about ourselves, even before we walked into the day, apart from performance or self-perception or what people think of us, what if we were in control of our self-esteem based upon God's first word to us? Does anybody get this? Does this resonate with anybody? Because, man, there was a season in my life, even as a pastor, where I had to decide every single morning I was going to decide to feel good about myself. Why? Because why would I feel crappy about myself? And why would I let anybody should on me? I said should on me. What would it look like if we were that secure because of God's goodness to us? What if we received it? What if we were that full of it? Man, I would want that. You see, Mary teaches us that true humility is agreeing with God about who we are and who he says we are. That you and I are favored and that he is with us. And what if we actually believed that and walked in this week of Christmas? What would that feel like? How many of you need to try that on? Why? Because I've come to this conclusion, nobody can make you feel inferior without your permission. Can I say that again? No one or nothing can make you feel inferior without your permission. But what if we were full of the goodness of God? Second thing is, not only do we need to say yes to the goodness of God, we need to say yes to the what even when we don't get the how. Can I say that again? You need to say yes to the what even when you don't get the how. You know what happens when you and I say yes to God's goodness? God asks us to do the impossible. That's what happens. When you say yes to his goodness, he doesn't keep you from hard things, because hard does not equal bad. hard is just hard. That's what Brian was saying. When he asked you to get out of the boat and take a step of faith, is that hard? Come on. Yeah, it is hard. But is it good? It is. If we're focused on him, I love Mary's honesty. I just love her honesty here. God says to her, Mary, I need you to bring my son into this dark, Roman, oppressed, and overtaxed, weary, selfish world. I need you to bring my goodness, my kingdom. And she asks an honest question. But here, this is free of charge. You know when God is asking you to do something, gang. You know this. Three ways you know this. First of all, nobody else is doing it around. What, God? You want us to plant a church in a movie theater? Nobody else is doing this in Windsor, Ontario. What? Heck no. Means it must be him. Second thing is it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. First of all, nobody else is doing it. Second of all, it doesn't make sense. Hold on. Lord, you want to use this old guy from Chatham to plant a church and follow a pastor with skinny jeans around? But that just doesn't make sense. And the last thing you know, when God's asking you to do something to bring his goodness to the world, it not only is nobody else doing it, it doesn't make sense, but it scares the heaven out of you. It scares the heaven out of you. It keeps you on your knees in true dependency upon him. Because we know if he doesn't show up, we're in trouble. This is so crazy, so big. We need an almighty God who still does miracles at Christmas. Amen? Oh. Mary asks, how can this be since I'm a virgin? You see, it's okay for Mary to admit or wonder. What's not okay is for her to use it as an excuse for not doing it. Abraham asked the same question. How can this be since my wife and I are barren? Moses said, how can this be when I can't speak? Gideon said, how can this be when I'm the least in my family, least in Israel? The disciples said, we can't feed all these people. How can this be since we don't have enough money? And we all wonder when God calls us to bring his goodness into the world, how can this be since I am a, you fill in the blank. Too old, too young, too busy, too tired, too sick, too broken, too addicted, too broke, too burdened, since we're all in this global pandemic. How can this be? You see, if true humility is agreeing with God about who he says you are, true dependency is agreeing about God about who he is, and nothing, gang, is impossible for him. So, Exchange, if you and I are doing something that's unique, doesn't make sense, and forces you on your knees every single day, you're not thinking to yourself, how can this be? There's still more for you. Can I tell you that? If there's no place that you need God's power to sustain what you're up to and what you're doing, if you don't need God for anything in your life these days, there's more for you. There's more goodness to dig into and to say yes to. There's more of the what that he has for you, even though you might not get the how. So first of all, we got to say yes to God's goodness if we're going to bring his goodness. Second of all, we need to say yes to the what, even though we don't get the how. Third thing, are you still with me, gang? Are you still with me? It's really quiet in here, yeah? Okay, so this just means that you're really thinking with me, right? Pondering, yeah? Okay, nobody's falling asleep yet? Because I'll turn the theater temperature down a couple degrees some more. Yeah. Third is that you need to say yes to his spirit every single day. You need to say yes to his spirit. So this goodness project that we got started, it started with one of these. I don't know whether you can see it. This is a single key. An 80-year-old who was a part of our church family and his wife started showing up at a public school to serve breakfast to under-resourced kids. And they showed up one Wednesday morning to flip pancakes, and there was a little 5-year-old who showed up, and he tugged on Wayne's shirt and said, "Hey, mister, see this?" He had a single key in his hand. Wayne said, what's that? He says, well, that's so I can lock the door when I leave it in the morning. And I can unlock it when I come home. This little guy got up at 5 years old all by himself, got dressed all by himself, walked to school all by himself. And after school was done, he walked home all by himself to let himself in. Well, there was a couple things that he couldn't do. He couldn't make his breakfast all by himself. And he couldn't make his lunch. Somebody else had to do that. And when he told Wayne that story and showed him the key, the Holy Spirit just ambushed this 80-year-old. Why? Because if you're not dead, say it with me, guys, you're not done. You're not dead. You're not done. That was a disaster, but that's okay. The reality is that he went home and that key actually got told, that story got told to us. We adopted Marlboro School. And last year we were able to put kids in coats and brand new running shoes. But this year, Jesus had something else for us. That he didn't want us just to take care of one school. He wanted to take care of, I think, 10 or 11. Hey, Neil? And we wrapped up yesterday where we saw over 250 people, families come through. 250 families come through yesterday. With an average, as Chris has said, all total over 500 families with the average of 4 kids in each family. It's 3,000 people that we were able to give goodness away to. Because of the generosity. We were able to raise $60,000 and give away $600,000 worth of resources to the West End who needed it the most. And if you could hear the stories of our personal shoppers as they heard stories of these beautiful fugitive families, most of them coming to Canada without anything, and with tears in their eyes saying, this is too good to be true. This is too good to be true. Who does this sort of thing? And the fact that we got to see miracle after miracle with these stories was just crazy. Now, here's the point of this. If you and I were to have gotten caught up into the how, like, you know, if somebody would have came to us and said, hey, you guys, you're going to do this. You're going to take care of 11 schools. We're going to create a goodness project in the West End. And we're going to give away $600,000 worth of stuff. You know what we would have said? You're absolutely nuts. You're crazy. But you know what we did? All we did was we said yes to the Holy Spirit. Yes to the Holy Spirit. We didn't have to figure it all out. All we did was take one step. The Holy Spirit would create a step, we would take it. The Holy Spirit would take another step, we would take it. The Holy Spirit would say, here's a step, and we would take it. And all of a sudden, it's done. It's absolutely done. Now, listen, some of you, can I just push on you a little bit? Some of you are going, well, I don't know this Holy Spirit thing. Listen, if you've never experienced leading or prompting or the direction of the Holy Spirit, you're missing out on the whole point of the Christian life. Again, can I say that again? If you've never, or if it's been a while, where you've never got a leading, an idea of the Holy Spirit. Doesn't speak verbally, but there's an idea that pops into your head or your heart, and you go, this is so crazy. This might even actually be from God. Like the Goodness Project was for us. We thought somebody had been smoking something. Can I just encourage you? You know, I always found it interesting how the disciples got to know Jesus better. Stace, I was thinking about this. How the disciples actually got to know Jesus better after he left them. How can that be? My grandma Atkinson died a while ago. And my relationship with her didn't stop. But there was no other relational opportunity with my grandma because she was gone. I have memories of her, but they're old memories. They're not new ones. And yet, the disciples, when Jesus died, rose again, sent his spirit. It's like, dang, now I know Jesus. And that's the same Holy Spirit that's available for you and I if we just say yes in order to bring goodness to our world. Which leads me to my last one here. My last way that we bring goodness is we say yes to God's goodness. We say yes to the what, even though we don't get the how, because the how is the Holy Spirit. We say yes to the Holy Spirit. And lastly, are you still taking notes? You say yes to bringing Jesus. You just say, yes, Lord, I'm going to bring Jesus. And you know what? Right about now, if I had a keyboardist, I'd bring, oh, there he is, Bri. What, yeah, guitar? Okay, come on, buddy. Who wants to hear Bri? Yeah, okay. That's a yes. So listen, you all know that Jesus is still looking for hearts. He's looking for room to be born through today. He's looking for lives that will bear him and bring him into our world. And I love this verse from O Little Town of Bethlehem. O little child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray, cast out our sin and enter in, be born in us today. And this is from John's gospel. And he was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He arrives at the front door of his own people's neighborhood, and they don't even check to see who's there. Yet to all who did open the door, their lives to him, received, believed, and said yes to him, he gave the right to become children of God, to be born into our world, full of the goodness of our God. Children of God, not born of parental passion, but of God's passion. Born of God. Are you born of God today, church? Because you've been born of his goodness, to bring his goodness. So beautiful. Being able to see how goodness spreads. It really is. And that's what I'm calling you and calling us to do this Christmas, is to bear Jesus to our world, to bring him. You see, Mary isn't any different than us. She is us. She models for us what the normal Christian life is all about. She brought Jesus into the world out of her one little yes, said in love. Jesus was born out of her passion for her God. How about you and I? What goodness, what fruit are we bearing as a result of Jesus growing in us? You see, Exchange, we become God-bearers when we bring Jesus into our worlds with one little yes. Yes to his goodness, yes to the impossibility, yes to his spirit, and yes to bringing Jesus into our Christmases every day. Ricky Bolden, some of you maybe have heard this story. Ricky Bolden was a 6'6", and he was 280 pounds, and he played offensive line for the Cleveland Browns before he felt Jesus calling him, the Spirit overshadowing him and saying, Ricky, I need you to be a pastor for me. So he left the NFL and the Cleveland Browns and became a pastor. But he found pastoring and encouraging his people to share Jesus and bring him into their neighborhoods tougher than blocking a defensive end or a middle linebacker. His flock pushed back on him, said, Pastor, we can't share our faith. We can't invite people. We can't bring Jesus into our world. And he said, why not? Why not? They said, Pastor, we don't know enough theology. He said, Church, what you talking about? He says, we don't know enough theology. He says, you don't need any theology. And so, what you talking about, Pastor? He says, you don't need any theology because you got buttology. They said, Pastor, not following you. What do you mean buttology? We don't need any theology because we got buttology? He says, y'all remember that you're highly favored. Amen? Y'all remember that, right, church? He says. That's where you guys pretend like I'm, amen, okay. He says, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I, listen, you don't need theology because you got a story. You got buttology. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. Could it be, church, that we don't, it's not that we don't know Jesus, it's just that we don't know him enough. It's not that Jesus isn't real to us, it's just that he's not real enough. Maybe we got the Holy Spirit, but the Holy Spirit needs more of us. Because when you're filled with the goodness of God, you're like little Atlas, who showed up at the Goodness Project the Friday night, came back on the Saturday with his mom in their pit bull. He says, Mom, I want to go through the Goodness Project. And his mom looks at Neil and says, I don't think going through the Goodness Project with a pit bull would be very good. That would be bad. And Neil says, I'll hold on to him for you. There's a step of faith. I think his name was Killer. No, I'm just kidding. Neil holds on to this pit bull that he never met, ever. And he sends a mom and little Atlas, 7 years old, through the Goodness Project. And they come out with two bags full of garbage. It was garbage bags. It wasn't garbage. Sorry, I said that wrong. Garbage bags full. And it was so good. He was so excited. And he came back. Came back the next Saturday with a friend. And he came back the next Saturday with a friend. I think Pastor Drew mentioned this last week. You see, goodness, gang. When you're full of goodness, it begets goodness. You bring goodness into our world. Amen? Yeah, amen. Amen. So, listen, I don't know. I don't know where you're at this morning as you're going into Christmas week. I feel like my heart is prepped because of all that we've been able to do through the Goodness Project. Because we've been able to see the goodness of our God in the land of the living. It started with a decision. It started with one simple yes. You know what I love about our God? I just love this about him. We matter so much to him. He honors us so much. He doesn't force his will on us, and he could because he's God Almighty. I wonder how many teenagers' homes Gabriel had to stop at before he got to Mary's and heard her one simple yes. And I wonder, maybe there's somebody here who's never said yes to God, never said yes to his goodness, still trying on your own to earn your acceptance rather than just accepting your acceptance with him out of his goodness and grace because you're highly favored. Some of you still don't believe it. And I can tell because of the pace of your life. You're still looking for love in all the wrong places. Jesus is going, would you just say yes to my goodness? That's what I died for. Some of you are still trying to figure this Christian thing out, and I'm so glad you are. If you haven't yet said yes yet, yeah, but you're almost there. I mean, I just want to give you a sense for what you're actually stepping into. You're saying yes to the what? Of bringing the goodness of God to our world. Even when you don't get the how, some of you just need to lay down the how right now. Because you know that God's at work, but you don't get the how, and you just need to surrender that to him. You need to say yes to the Holy Spirit. Some of you have never surrendered your lives to the Holy Spirit. And you might be born again from him, but he doesn't have full control of your life. You see, this goodness comes. Mary had to come to this place where she said, I believe, I receive, Lord. I surrender. Because I want to bring goodness to our world. I want to bear Jesus to our world. But it started with her one simple yes. And what I love about God, he didn't force that on her. Your call. But I wonder, maybe there's some of you who'd be willing to stand with me as we go into the Christmas week and just, again, surrender ourselves. Say yes again to the message of Christmas and bringing and bearing Jesus to the world. Anybody be willing to do that with me? Yeah? Would you? Okay, so if you are, why don't you just stand wherever you're at, and we're gonna pray. Amen? And if you want to, an act of surrender, and this might be a stretch, this might be a first stretch for you, just reach your hands up to heaven to receive the goodness of God. You don't have to, but man, if that is helpful to you. So Jesus, we want to say thank you for coming. Thank you for coming for us. Thank you for being the good and perfect gift that came down from heaven, our good, good Father. Cradle to crown. But we also know that in between the cradle and the crown, there was a cross to show us how good you are and how much you love us. So Lord, we together as a church, as we enter into Christmas week, we say yes to your goodness again. Don't we, gang? If you want to just say, yes, Lord, yeah. Yes to your goodness. We say yes to the what, even though we don't get the how. We say yes to the Holy Spirit. Yes, Holy Spirit. And we say yes to bringing Jesus and bearing him to our world again this Christmas. So Lord, Mary prayed, I am the Lord's servant. Let it be to me according to his word. And we enter into her faith, which was a gift from you. And we say the same, oh Lord, we here at Exchange Church are your servants. Let it be to us according to your word, even this Christmas. And we pray these things in the powerful name of Jesus. And everybody said, and everybody said, amen, amen, amen. Listen, Merry Christmas, everybody. Listen, we'll see you either Thursday night, right? And, or we'll see you online on the 26th. And if not, we'll see you next year. Yeah, thanks, everybody, for coming. Yeah, have a great, great day. Yep.
Tonight, and that's enough.